Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Monday, July 24th, 2023 meeting of Reading City Council. If you're with us in person, we welcome you. If you are viewing this virtually, we welcome you as well. We will begin this evening with the invocation from Pastor Jessica Scott, Senior Pastor of the Temple Prayer Road to Damascus. Welcome, Pastor. Thank you for joining us in person.
Thank you for having me. Can we all bow our heads for prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you for this day, oh God. We thank you for the opportunity to just be in your presence one more time. Father, we ask your presence into this room tonight, Father. We ask your presence to fall in this place, oh God. We ask you to allow your spirit to just go throughout this room, Father, that every decision be made among your people, Father. We ask you to allow all clarity to come forth tonight, Father, because we know that you are the author and finisher of our faith. You are the great creator of this fine earth. Father, you are the great I am and the King of Kings. Father, we thank you for this opportunity tonight, Father, to be amongst each and every one of us tonight, Father. We would not be here without you, God. Without you, oh Father, we can't do anything. So we need your presence tonight in this room, God. We need your presence among all those who are in this in place tonight, Father, all those who are in position, Father, for your purpose and for your glory. We ask every issue to come to the table tonight, Father, that your decision may be made, Father. We ask you to allow your voice to be heard tonight. We ask you just to use every personal, Father, that is bringing forth conversation, bringing forth issues, bringing forth concerns, Father God, to bring forth, oh God, what you will need for this city. We thank you for every representative of this city, God. We thank you for their hard work. We thank you for what you do. And we thank you for your continuous works among us, Father, because we can't do anything without you. Father, so we just bless you right now, Father God. We bless your presence tonight, God. We bless your presence among every speaker tonight, God. We pray, God, boldness will fall from them, God. We pray that everyone will speak according to what they have in their hearts, God. We pray that you will just have your will in this place. We thank you, Father, for every opportunity. We thank you for your presence, and we thank you for who you are, because you are the great I am. We give you glory tonight. We give you honor, and we give you praise. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you again, Pastor. Linda, may we have the roll call, please?
Mr. Butler?
Here.
Mr. Daubert?
Here.
Ms. Goodman-Henderschitz?
Here.
Mr. Miller?
Here.
Ms. Ventura?
Here.
Ms. Negron?
Here.
Ms. Reed, President?
Here.
Seven present, none absent.
Just to note that we had an executive session was held after the conclusion of Cal Committee of the Whole this afternoon, and that was on litigation. So we go forward now in proclamations and presentations, recognizing Ruben Rodriguez as Athlete of the Year. Is he going to be with us, or?
He's not here.
He's not here?
No, what? He's not connected virtually. We did send him the link.
Okay. Do we want to hold off a little bit to see if he, and then we'll just deviate from the agenda if everyone's okay with that? When he joins us, is that okay with everyone? Okay.
Yeah, and if he doesn't join us, we can do it the next meeting.
Okay.
Yeah.
If everyone's okay with that. Okay, great. And we can recognize him twice, which is fine, tonight and next time. Okay, then we will go on to public comment. Linda, how many folks do we have?
119.
Okay. Chris, do you want to take over?
Sure. Thank you, Council President. Those individuals registered to speak on agenda matters will be allotted no more than 5 minutes, and those individuals registered to speak on non-agenda matters will be allotted no more than 3 minutes. The city clerk will control a timer to monitor these time periods. When the alarm rings, a speaker must immediately end their comment. If a speaker refuses to comply, the microphone at the podium will be turned off and the next speaker will be given the floor. These time periods also apply to written comments that are being read into the record, such that any written comment may only be read into the record for a 5-minute period for agenda items and a 3-minute period for non-agenda items. The president of council or majority of council may grant an additional period of time in their discretion. All public comment must be directed to council as a body and not to any individual council member or public or elected official in attendance. Public comment is an opportunity to make a statement only. It is not designed for questioning, and there is no guarantee or requirement for a question presented during public comment to be answered or responded to. Each speaker shall speak clearly and slowly. No speaker shall register or speak more than once at a meeting. A speaker shall not comment in a manner that is disruptive, scandalous, impertinent, redundant, rude, unruly, personally offensive, irrelevant to the registered topic, done for the purpose of preventing the conduct of the business of the meeting or promotion of candidates at an upcoming election, or otherwise in disregard to the rules of order or decorum. Any such comment will not be accepted or included in the record. In the event that a speaker or written comment violates any of these rules, that speaker or written comment will be deemed to have forfeited their right to public comment, and the president of council or majority of city council may direct the city clerk to turn off the microphone or cease reading the comment into the record, have the individual removed from council chambers and/or cited. All persons in attendance are expected to conduct themselves in a responsible and respectful manner that does not disrupt the meeting. Clapping, calling out, cheering, or interrupting speakers or the discussions of city council during or after a public comment is not permitted. Those wishing to have conversation should do so in the hall outside council chambers in a low speaking voice. All right, so those are the rules for public comment. Tonight we have one speaker on non-agenda matters, Paul Mazzotta. Paul, welcome. The microphone is already on. You're speaking on non-agenda, so you have 3 minutes.
Hello? Okay. Thank you for letting me speak tonight. After doing business in the city of Reading for the past 30 years, at my encouragement, my father had purchased a building in 94 to conduct business here. Unfortunately, he passed away last year, and I am here to approach the city with a wonderful opportunity to turn my dad's building into probably two scenarios. One of them, which I feel is a great idea to benefit the city, the community, and the greater good, could be a police station. Right now, the police are operating out of City Hall, and they're parking in the alleyway behind City Hall where their vehicles aren't secure. So you could take this property, which is 105 Washington Street, 7 blocks from City Hall, devote the entire property to the police, and there is a 5-story Reading Parking Authority garage directly across the street. There's a second 5-story parking garage also operated by Reading Parking Authority at 2nd and Washington, and a third at 3rd and Washington. So there's plenty of public parking, and there's a bus stop at the building. The other idea is to do housing mimicking what they did at the Goggle Works Apartments building. You could build a structure just like that, 5 stories or less, either above retail or above nothing, or above a police substation. So I wanted to make this a public comment tonight, and I watched your city council meeting on July 3rd, where you talked about the city's budget, which is public information. And I'd like to cite that for the record right now, really quick, before I end my speech. You have a bank balance of $39 million, a general fund of $37 million, a general investment balance of $16.5 million, a $103 million annual budget, $55 million in annual revenue from property taxes, and $12 million from income taxes. Also $3 million from real estate transfer tax. And when I looked up property records, the City of Reading and the City of Reading Redevelopment Authority both own numerous parcels in the city limits. My dad's building is 105 Washington Street, zip code 19601, so it is in the city. It's in an economic opportunity zone, which means there's federal, state, and city funding available for development. It's 1 block from Penn Street. It's adjacent to RAC, Reading Area Community College, next to the Goggle Works Apartments and Goggle Works Arts Center, and the IMAX movie theater. So if you'd like to follow up with me, please do so during normal business hours, and we can speak about this in private. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mazzotta. as that was the only public comment tonight, Council President, back to you.
And thank you. Thank you, sir, for coming in. We appreciate it. Okay, we'll go next to the approval of agenda and minutes. The agenda is for today, July 24th, 2023. The minutes are from the July 10th regular meeting and summations of discussion from the July 10th meeting, Committee of the Hall. We have two awards of contract on this consent agenda. Is everyone in agreement to move forward? Any objections? Okay. The first award of contract is award A for a CoStars purchase from the Asphalt Paving Group to refurbish the Bear Park tennis courts and a 6th and Amity basketball court for a total of $93,000 from the court resurfacing CIP budget. Currently to date, the city has allocated or completed projects totaling $352,235.63 of these funds at the refurbishment of parks throughout the city. B, resolution authorizing the amendment of CDBG-CV action plan, moving $500,000 from the CDBG-CV administration and CDBG-CV micro enterprise activities and to the Liberty Fire Station Museum HVAC project. In addition, Public Works will use $210,000 in city capital, non-CDBG-CV funding for the project. The total project cost is $710,000. CDBG-CV CARES Act funding is permitted to be used for CDBG eligible and fundable activities to prevent, prepare for, and respond to coronavirus. So with that, the consent agenda and the minutes are approved. We will go on now to ordinances for final passage. Bill number 65-2023, authorizing the execution of a sales agreement in the amount of $20,000 for the sale of property owned by the city adjacent to the Berks County Regional Airport to the adjoining property owner, Colin Wyatt, introduced at the June 12th regular meeting and tabled at the June 26th and July 11th regular meetings. Is there a motion?
Motion to table.
Second.
Okay, without discussion for tabling motions, Linda, may we please have a roll call?
I just discovered that there's a problem with the meeting link. That's why we don't have a bunch of people on.
Okay.
And there's nothing I can do about that.
But back in the day, you didn't have it.
Yeah. So is it being streamed though?
Oh yeah, it's being streamed.
Okay, and it's on, yeah. And it's on Mac then.
Not yet. I can send the recording.
Okay, but it's being streamed.
Yeah, okay. There's a complete meltdown with the link.
Okay.
That it may have been the storm or.
Okay, so Mr. Rubina, Emily, if you can let him know, he might have to just call in or something. Okay.
Okay. Getting back to business.
Melissa still will have a question for him.
Motion was made by Councilor Ventura, seconded by Councilor Goodman-Hinderschitz to table bill number 65-2023. Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
Yes.
Ms. Negron?
Yes.
Ms. Reed, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Okay, we go to Bill 70-2023, amending Bill 52-2023 to provide funding for City Council District events by reducing the amount of the annual allocation to $15,000. That's $2,500 for each of the 6 council districts. This was introduced at the July 11th regular meeting. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any conversation? I think this was discussed pretty significantly over the last few weeks. There's no conversation. We'll go to a vote.
Motion was made by Councilor Miller, seconded by Councilor Ventura, to enact Bill number 70-2023, which amends Bill 52-2023 by reducing the annual allocation for council events to $15,000. Which is $2,500 per council district. Mr. Daubert?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Ms. Ventura?
Yes.
Ms. Negron?
Yes.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Ms. Reed, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Okay, that takes us to the introduction of new ordinances. Mr. Butler, would you do the honors, please?
Yes, we have a ordinance amending the City of Reading Code of Ethics by adding council district events / community promotions to the prohibited behaviors in section 5-1006. Lastly, we have B ordinance amending the City Code Chapter 576, Section 576-207, which is one-way roadways established by changing the flow of traffic in the 1800 block of North 12th Street to one-way street in a southbound direction.
Thank you, Mr. Butler. We do have a resolution again in the pending box, and that involves the Downtown Plus Strategic Master Plan, and we will look to the administration for guidance on that when we're ready to move forward. Next, we have the report from department directors, boards, authorities, and commissions. Emily from the zoning department has left to try to contact Phil Rubina as who is chair. If everyone is okay going out of order, let's go to the reports, and we can go first to the council report, go around the table. Mr. Miller, you want to start?
Thank you. Obviously, most of my week was spent in Reutlingen, Germany with council president and some other people from Reading visiting our sister city. It was a great time while we were there, although it was a little warm, and Europe does not believe in air conditioning, so that made it interesting. But that aside, there were a lot of conversations that were discussed about the two cities and the things that we have in common and the things that are very different. And I think that was probably the best part, to talk to somebody else about city issues coming from a different viewpoint, because obviously a city in Europe is very different than Reading, but they do have a lot of the same issues that we deal with and how they deal with it compared to us. Some of the things, I think they were way ahead of us, that they've been working with for years, where we're just starting to. And that was really enlightening. And I think that's going to be something that hopefully I can start conversations here, that we can move in the same direction that they are now. I also think that the city of Reutlingen is looking for additional partnerships with other departments within city government and also other entities in the city. And we'll work towards that too. When we came back, the very next day was the dedication of the White's Pavilion at RAC at 10 o'clock in the morning, which was a little bit of a challenge dealing with jet lag, but it was a great event. And in honor of the non-air conditioning in Europe, I think they decided to make it a really hot day for us, but we all managed it. Luckily they had a tent and they did have fans. And I think the people that were there for the dedication realized that this is such a good project that the heat sort of wasn't an issue. I think the project will really be a great asset to RAC and to the community. And as a lot of people mentioned during the dedication, with RAC being located right as you come over the Penn Street Bridge, it is part of the gateway to the city of Reading. So it is important that as they grow, the city grows too. And the last thing is, this past weekend was the Columbian Festival at the courtyard in the 600 block of Penn Street. And that was a great event. It was well attended. And it was great to see the courtyard, which was just renovated last year, being used by the citizens of Reading. That's all I have to report.
My comments are going to be somewhat the antithesis of Mr. Miller's comments tonight, and that was all very positive. I'm tremendously concerned with the uptick in gun violence that we're seeing in our city. And not just that, but with the lack of cooperation among some members of our community in terms of assisting with what's going on there. The answer, if I had the answer, and if all of us had the answer, it would already be done, right? You know, if the answer was easy, it would already be done. But I do know that government cannot do this alone, and that ultimately we're going to need the public's help in helping to stem this tide that we're seeing, which, I mean, I think it was 4 instances over the weekend. And you know, government can't solve it all. That's for sure. But I think as we move towards budget season, my votes and my priorities are going to reflect what I'm seeing right now in terms of the violence that's plaguing our city. So that's my less than positive report, but I think it needed to be said.
My concerns is the violence, which I think that we need more activity for the youth in order to keep them away from the trouble that has been plagued with the city, which is the youth.
Yeah, there's a summer league basketball going on at Bear Park for young adults. I got to play in it this Sunday, and it just started up about, I would say, this month. The owner of the league is Bob Waples, and it's about 8 teams in it. So, like, it just started, but I just wanted to give him a shout out because he just sort of started this month on, like, short time since the court, since we had the court redone. So I just wanted to give a shout out to him.
Anything else, Mr. Beller?
Yeah, that was the only thing I had. Yeah.
Can I ask what the age range is for the players?
It's like high school kids all the way up to, like, I don't know, like 20, yeah. 25.
It's a beautiful court. It's great to see it used that much. So our kudos to everybody. So thanks, Wes. Yeah. Marcia?
Okay, first, on behalf of City Council, and together with our managing director, Bill Heim, I attended the ribbon cutting ceremony at the Oakbrook Community Center. And I think it's a good investment of our federal funding to support the center with the multitude of services they're gonna have available, from childcare to a food market to housing for social service agencies. And one of the, just to keep it in reality check, if you look at where Oakbrook's located at, the last time that they had a functioning supermarket within walking distance was over 50 years ago. My husband managed it. That's how I know that. So it's a half a century that those folks have been living in a food desert, if you may. And so I think we really need to look, as we prioritize, how that can help. But one of the good parts about Oakbrook is because of the structure and supervision, support of the police department, other social service agencies, that is probably one of the safer parts of the city to live in, if you look at where we're seeing the violence occur. So I think there's a lesson to be learned about the fact that if you create structure and a sense of community, you can be overcoming some of the things that lead to violence. So that being said, I've been hearing gunshots, of course, loud music, and responding to requests from my constituents, being concerned about some of the racing going on up and down Hill Road. So what happens is people race up Hill Road as a way to get up on the Skyline Drive. And I've had to intercede working with the managing director about a vendor who's not operating and hasn't been operating for many, many, many years at the site of the Reading Pagoda, but found that there's probably health violations going on. So I'm looking forward to the city administration following through. If we're going to be having vendors, they have to be operating their facilities following all codes and working in cooperation with the city. Probably the sad news, but we knew it was going to happen, is they have started demolition on the Mineral Spring Hotel. But what I'd like to use is the money that was set aside for community meetings to bring together a meeting with community partners in the early fall to talk about how we reuse that area, including Mineral Spring Park, Pandora Park, all the way up through Eggleman's. I think that's what we really need to be using these community meetings, is to engage citizens in planning. And so I thank you, and I look forward to the rest of the summer, and hopefully everything stays safe. And we do get together to talk about the issue of gun violence. We just can't avoid that at this point. Thank you.
Melissa?
I don't really have much. All I have is the Blacktop Championship Games are being held today and tomorrow, beginning at 6 p.m. at Reading High School. So go out and support our youth. Thank you.
And I won't repeat a lot. We had a very interesting time over in Reutlingen and exchanged a lot of ideas from expanding our partnership culturally, athletically, academically, governmentally. So I think we have a lot of potential potential expansions there, and we look forward to doing those things and making it even more vibrant and more relevant. They are a city that is experiencing major demographic changes with immigration, and it has impacted the diversity. It's a far more diverse place than a town in Southwest Germany would expect, but it is. It's very interesting, and I think it's very healthy to see what is happening there. Not that it doesn't come with its challenges, but we thank as we played host to members of their delegation. We thank them for their hosting us, and there is coming in the mail, or postal service, or UPS, or Federal Express, or whatever you want to do, a very large street sign that was presented to the city. And when it arrives here, the next council meeting after it arrives here, we will try to do a Zoom link with Mayor Keck, and hopefully the mayor will be at the council meeting so that he can virtually present the street sign that will be sitting here. So we'll figure out exactly where that'll be located. So, and that reflects the reason we were there, which is the 25th anniversary of the twinning of the two cities. So again, we are glad to have that connection, and we look to expand it and grow it with the next generation. Next. Okay. Is everybody okay if we hold off administrative report and go to the zoning hearing? Okay. Okay, Mr. Rubina.
Okay, I apologize for this getting on with you guys. I had a bit of a problem, so I apologize. Anyway, this is the annual report for the Zoning Board for the City of Reading. And I would like to introduce the members of the board. Mr. Price is our solicitor. Mr. Bars, Mr. Fox, Mr. Gattone, Mr. Harst. I'm Phil Rubina. I'm the chairperson. And we have Mr. Jones as our alternative member. The zoning staff consists of Ms. Sassaman, who's the acting zoning administrator, Ms. Diaz-Melendez, who's our zoning officer, Ms. Caroli, who's a consultant, Ms. Kozop, who's our zoning officer, and Ms. Velasco Rosales is a clerk. And I want to say a special thanks to these people for the factual report that you got and was submitted to you. They do a great job for us all year round, and we're very grateful to have them working with us. So just some general comments. We continue to have more people coming to deal with zoning issues before they go off and do something. And the zoning staff continues to provide us with accurate and timely information. Our solicitor continues to supply us with sound advice and counsel. And I think the city's use of the one stop continues to be a great asset to all of this. It really helps people get off to the right foot when they want to do something. Our official interpreters have also been a great asset to us and to the applicants. And as I said before, the zoning officer office works well with us, but they also work well with the applicants, because if an application is denied, they have very clear reasons why it was denied and the things that would need to be rectified in order to get approval. So that is extremely helpful. And the Zoom process has been working well for us. We have some technical issues once in a while, but for the most part, it goes well. It's actually allowed us, and in many cases, attorneys and the interpreters to maybe do a couple of jobs in one evening because of that. So I think in many ways it's been helpful, even though it does have some problems. We try to make every effort to treat the applicants and each other with respect. We continue to grant continuances for some appeals in order to gain more complete information. And the nice thing about that is the applicant, particularly if it's just a small issue, doesn't have to reapply and spend more money. It gives them a time to get some things together, and we can make a much better decision. We continue to try to be consistent in our rulings, but again, this is an old city, and you have to look at each appeal as an individual set of circumstances. You know, we always want to understand the intent of the law and the letter of the law. And I think more important in Reading is you kind of have to know the history of a property, what the current circumstances are, and what might be the future positives and negatives of our decision on any matter. And I know that sounds a little bit pie in the sky, but I think it really has worked. Some of the issues we have. Parking continues to be an issue. That doesn't come as a surprise to any of you. And it's a major consideration in our decisions. And then there's the legal and illegal conversion of properties to multifamily units. Kind of at the rate of things are going, single family homes will only be a minor part of our housing available. And the R3 zone, while it's permitted, is particularly hard hit. I think one of the other things that concern us is undersized units, dwelling units, and also overcrowding of sites. And this is counter to the city's plan to try to reduce density for a better life quality. We kind of take exception to this international building code that doesn't, in our opinion, reflect adequate size housing for individuals. And, you know, again, it might work in Singapore and Hong Kong or Philadelphia or New York, but I don't think that all of the things that they recommend in there are particularly helpful. We've been making adjustments to the zoning applications to get more accurate and complete information for the appeals, and we're going to continue to look at that to refine that process. And we've also talked about this before. The city needs more staff to follow up to see if violations have been removed or if approvals have been given that they've been fully implemented and as approved. And I think once people know there's fair enforcement, they will be more in compliance. We had some recommendations. First, find a way to keep quality zoning administrators. We have too high a rate of turnover, and that's really not healthy for the city or the staff. The codes that permit the apartment conversions we think need to be revisited. This brings in a lot of transient population that has no long-term stake in the city. Also, more apartments create more parking, more trash, more crowding, more problems for our schools. And those are all quality of life issues. Codes relating to the size of apartments, that should also be revisited. And I've kind of mentioned that before. And the thing is that that can't be an absolute thing, because many times a building structure dictates what can or can't be done, or how it's going to be used also sometimes dictates whether you could use smaller or larger units. And again, that's another life issue. And apartment conversions must include parking plans to match the number of units. We've been pretty resolute about that lately. And it is amazing that when people really work at it, they can find ways to get parking and it can be permanent. And that works both for the city and it works both for the people that are renting the apartment. And one last thing that we didn't put on there, and I should have, I neglected that, was to look at the fee schedule. I know some of these projects that are applications that we review seem pretty simple, but when you dig into them, sometimes the net effect of what the zoning office has to do to check these out and to make sure they work and to get the applicant accurate information, particularly if you're going to deny it, takes sometimes a lot more time than you think. And I think in working on that, there is a delicate balance, because you don't want to price people out of the market by making the rates too high, but maybe there could be found a way that sometimes, as things might take more or less time, that some of those fees could be adjusted, and we think that would help everybody. So just in closing, I'd like to say it's been an honor for all of us to serve in the city of Reading. And for me personally, I very much enjoyed this. This is going to be my last appointment on the Zoning Hearing Board. I've been doing this for a lot of years. And at the end of this, I won't be applying for any more duty. Anyway, we also need to keep quality people in our city. We talked about turnover. And under this section of recommendations and a couple of things that I said, the city has already taken time to dialogue with me on some of those issues, and we appreciate that, and we hope it continues. If you haven't had time to review the details of the report, the factual reports, so to speak, please do so. If there's any questions, the zoning office or myself, whatever, we'll endeavor to find any answers to questions that you might have. And I guess one last thing that I'd like to say is that zoning and codes are the glue that kind of hold a city together and make it a pleasant place for all people to live. And I think those two items next to public safety need to be a major consideration of government in terms of staff, funding, and constant attention to rules and regulations. You know, the world, as we know, has changed quickly, and government needs to keep pace with changes that dictate those new needs. And I know that all of you are interested in making Reading a great place to live. We greatly appreciate having Mr. Jones as an alternate. His knowledge of the city as well as other topics has been a great asset to us. And I want to say a special thanks to Ms. Caparel, who is our stenographer, and Ms. Hoppe, who is Mr. Price's secretary, because they keep things flowing back and forth and keep the process moving for all of us. So I want to thank all of you for the opportunity to address you on behalf of the board. And should you have any questions now or later, I'd be happy to take time and discuss any things with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ravina. Questions?
Yes.
Marcia?
Hello, Mr. Ravina. How are you doing?
Good. How about you?
District 2 resident. So you brought up a very important issue about being concerned about density. And I think everyone in this body is concerned about that. What do we need to do to strengthen our zoning code so we do not see more dense housing occurring, because the city can't support that from your point of view? So you can make decisions that will not allow continued density within the city.
I think some of this has to do with mostly small unit. I think what you have given in terms of your code, I think is pretty good. But in many cases, I think it actually needs to be expanded perhaps a little bit more. I think just upping those numbers a little bit would help. And sometimes, like for example, we had one before us where there was a, they were gonna have a location for veterans. And it was an older building. Now these were basically gonna be single people. And, you know, it was set up for a specific purpose. So if that unit's a little bit smaller, it's no big deal. It will work for the purpose that's there. And you're right, you know, we kind of have to pay attention to that. And sometimes it doesn't always work the way we would like it. And, but sometimes things just need to be approved. And I'm thinking there's got to be a way that maybe there's more flexibility in that, in the way that the code's written. And, you know, I'm not an attorney and I don't pretend to be one, but I think maybe if people look around at what happens in other municipalities similar to Reading, I think that might be very helpful to us.
Other questions from the body? Melissa, anything? Anyone?
I'm Melissa. Hi. It's Councilor Ventura here. So I had a question about a month ago or two at a hearing. I signed up for public comment and I signed up to speak in regards to the 601 Penn property. And I believe Marsha spoke first and then I was speaking. However, I was interrupted and was told, you know, that wasn't my district and I didn't live in that neighborhood. So I couldn't speak on that property. However, when you sign up for public comment, it doesn't ask you those, like I'm not asked those questions. So I felt that was rude when that happened. So why did that happen?
Okay, under the zoning code, you have to have a direct interest in it. And this brings up a good point. I'm glad you mentioned that. For example, if somebody wants to come as a member of city council and say, I'm here representing city council, you don't necessarily have to be in that particular district, okay? Or if you are saying, yeah, I'm a council person, but I want to speak tonight just as a person, not as a member of council. I don't, you know, I'm just giving you my feelings. I think sometimes it's how you say what your interest is in that. And I know that sometimes that is something that does hurt people's feelings, and that isn't the intent. But there are certain rules by which people can testify or not testify. And I can get more information on that and see that that's rooted to you so that you have an exact comment about that.
And then also, so I was asked that, but Marsha spoke and she wasn't asked anything. So that was another thing that got me.
Well, I'm glad that you said that because we try not to be offensive to people and we try to let people have their say. And I'm glad that you felt free to speak up.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Chris.
Thank you, Sarah, for your years of service. You spoke earlier about your belief that the city would do well by expanding some of the requirements in terms of square footage and how important that was for the city moving forward. That said, I'm just kind of a little bit surprised to hear that because some recent big ticket rulings out of your office, and I know you're only one vote, have been totally incongruent with that. So I know you're only one vote, but
I think you're right to question that. You know, I don't take offense to that. This was a situation where we had many people for it and many people against it. And I think if we would have ruled against it, somebody would have litigated it. If we ruled for it, which we did, somebody's going to litigate it. It's one of those kinds of things that sometimes we looked at the city, we looked at downtown, we looked at what might be available, what we saw as some of the issues with it. And while we weren't 100% pleased, and I don't know if you heard my comments afterwards that I made when we did that vote, we weren't totally pleased with everything there. And one of the things we said was, in order to make this work, a lot of people are going to have to work together to carry it out. And I was hoping that that's might be what would happen, because I think either way we rule, for or against, somebody was going to litigate that. And, you know, it was just a decision that we made. We weren't totally pleased with it, but we just felt downtown Reading might be able to pull this off and it might be an asset. And that's pretty much what we decided. But I can tell you there were other situations where people wanted to pack a lot of apartments in, and we restricted them to certain numbers. And as a result, they were able to get it done. And I don't know if that would be possible here. I think if somebody sat down and scratched their head real hard, I think somebody could come up with a plan to, at least if they couldn't make some of the smaller units bigger, they could at least make them pretty close to what the city requires. So, you know, I really take no offense or umbrage to your comments, because that was a tough decision for us to make.
Can I just ask, thank you for that. Can I just ask, because you said that on many, many times, you guys have followed the stated size requirements. What was different in this case?
Well, as I said, some of you, we have a letter. We had a letter from the mayor supporting it. We had a letter from other people supporting it. We had some people in city government that said they didn't support it. And I think what you pointed out there was, it's not our job to tell somebody on a project how to run the, I don't know how to say this. We can't do their planning for them. And that's why I made that statement at the end, that people needed to work together. Because what I think we were hoping was that instead of winding up in court, somebody would sit down, all the parties would sit down together and try to figure out what's the best way to make this work. And, you know, it doesn't appear that that's the way it's going to go. And, you know, and I will tell you, anytime that you have to make a decision or a judgment, we're not infallible. And I've always believed one of the things that when the old Reading Eagle was around, anytime council disagreed with something we did or whatever, they would call and they say, well, you know, how do you feel about this? And my answer always was, that's the process. If somebody appeals a decision that we have made and we're overruled, I take no offense to it. That's the process. And I think that's kind of what we looked at. And I think that we really felt that if everybody sat down and talked about it, you could work something out that would work for the city. And that's the best answer I can honestly give you.
Yeah, I understand. I'm putting you in a tough spot. And I also do want to say very publicly, thank you for your many years of service. I know you've given a lot to the city. So I do appreciate your service.
I appreciate that. And, you know, one of the things that I have learned is that, A, never think you're infallible, and never believe your own publicity. It's not a healthy thing to do. And so I appreciate that you folks felt free to speak up. And I would hope that any of you on city council, whatever, any department, if you want to come and be part of those hearings, you're always more than welcome. And, you know, so anything else from anybody?
Okay, well, thank you for your time, Emily. Thank you for the preparation of the report. And we'll hope that you'll keep busy in the next year or so, because busy means things are happening in the city.
We'll give it a college try. And again, thanks to all of you. We appreciate your support. Good evening.
Good evening. Thank you. And thank you, Emily. Okay, we will go on now to the administrative report. Mr. Hahn.
Once again, you have a 10-page report. There's really nothing substantial in this report that wasn't contained last week, just some updates that you can read. So the only thing I want to mention, over the past few weeks, the mayor has had a series of meetings with the federal government, Department of Health and Human Services representatives, the Housing and Urban Development Department with some of their staff. Also, I met with the staff of Senator Casey and Senator Fetterman. And also, he met with some of the governor's staff and DCED, all surrounding various housing issues, health issues, including the progress of some of our grants, and also city revitalization needs. So he has been busy in that account, and I think he brought some of the directors into those meetings to kind of talk about the city's needs. So I think that was some worthwhile endeavors. Thank you.
And that's great to hear that. I would respectfully ask that in the future, if possible, president of council or council representative be included in those meetings, because I think it's important for us to be kept directly informed as to what's going on. I understand the difference between administration and council, but we do all work together, and maybe being in those meetings will be helpful to progressing the city.
I can make those requests, but most of these meetings were precipitated by the federal and state offices themselves.
And generally, people are pretty open to adding folks to the meeting. So I would request that really in general terms, because the more we know directly, the better, more likely cooperation will be involved. Marcia?
Yeah, and to add on to that, direct response to what I read in the media about there being the Secretary of Transportation coming tomorrow. I'm sure the administration was invited to that meeting. I didn't know whether council was or not.
I have not been.
Okay.
Is there any way council can be invited? I believe it's at 645 Penn Street, I read.
Arranged by Representative Guzman.
Okay. So it'd be up to him to extend the invitation, I would think. Okay.
And the only reason I broke it up, you're a representative on the Reading Area Transportation Study. So we all have roles to play, and maybe our legislators don't understand that, but I just think it's a good collaborative process, because we're not going to get anything done by all flying in our own silos, you know?
So I don't know, Chief, if you could reach out and find out about that. I would try to make myself available in between appointments if it's feasible, if you can let me know. If not myself, maybe someone else would be available.
Okay.
Okay.
I believe that's tomorrow morning, right?
I think so. I believe that's what I heard.
Okay. I'll do my best.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate it. Just let me know and I will keep. Yeah. Marcia.
Yeah, and I do have another comment. And I, first of all, want to thank the work of all the city departments. And of course, I always have a shout out to Public Works. And the reason I'm bringing this up now is I was just looking at a posting on Facebook that is so tragic that unfortunately the Eggleman's Pavilion, the picnic tables and stuff were vandalized. And so the city has put an incredible amount of funding into rebuilding that pavilion. It's absolutely elegant. It is secure in that the park is closed. So obviously someone made a real effort. So we need to talk about that because I'm seeing this happen consistently with our playgrounds. I'm sure you're aware of it. It just seems like we invest money in good things and then the vandalism continues to occur. And it's probably tied in with, And so it's probably tied into a lot of other things that we're seeing with the violence and such, but it just concerns me that we need to come up with something more proactive. And again, we're not all gonna be able to do it individually. We have to work together on it. So I will be visiting the pavilion. I don't think I'll have time to do it tonight before it's gonna get too dark, but certainly tomorrow to be able to see what the conditions are.
Anyone else? Okay, Maria. It's up to you and a belated happy birthday. You're not counting those numbers, right?
No. We say 29 forever, right?
Yeah, we're all in agreement on that. Consensus.
Thank you, Council President. Good evening, everybody. I completed the annual audit for the fire escrow account. The audit was completed from January 4, 2022 through December 31st, 2022. Part of this audit was also to reconcile the fire escrow cash receipts and disbursement. The data needed for this audit was provided by the treasury manager who is responsible to maintain a log with all the necessary information for each property from which the proceeds were received. These proceeds are received from the fire escrow insurance and it appeared to have been historically deposited into the fire escrow account on the Fund 31. The data received has been reviewed and analyzed by the city auditor, which tied to the trial balance that was given by the city controller. The liability ending balance of the fire escrow account as of December 31st, 2022 is $773,518.58. If we see table number two in the audit report, we can see that about 56% of the proceeds has been received from 2017 and prior years, which has caused a significant increase to this liability. In 2022, $208,678.25 was disbursed. However, the city still has a credit liability of $773,518.58 compared to the 2021 liability of $755,427.45, which is like about $18 higher than 2021. The report was sent to all council members. So if you have any question, just please feel free to.
Thank you, Maria. Any questions?
I'm sorry. I just want to say that my recommendation to the administration is that they should have a plan in place to implement a plan to, you know, to see how this liability can be reduced because every year is going up a little bit. Yep. Thank you.
Thank you, Maria. Any questions for our auditor? No. Well, thank you always for your thorough work.
Thank you.
And that pretty much concludes the business of this meeting. One thing I forgot to mention in council comments was the gardens at Berkshire Greens, the community gardens that the neighbors have put together. If you get the opportunity behind a Glenside school, you want to take a little picnic lunch. It's a beautiful endeavor. And we thank Penn State Berks and Penn State Extension for their help with that. But it's very pretty, so go check it out. Okay, we're going to the council meeting schedule now. Thursday, July 27th, this Thursday, we have liquor license transfer hearing, 600 Penn Street, council chambers at 5. Monday, July 31st, we have nominations and appointment at 4, and we have charter and ethics orientation in council chambers at 5. Monday, August 7th, nominations and appointment committee, Penn Room, 4 p.m., strategic planning in council chambers at 5. Monday, August 14th, committee of the whole, council chambers at 5, and a regular meeting at 7. And then Monday, August 21st, we have nominations and appointments committee in a Penn Room 4, conditional use hearing for 411 South 14th Street regarding conversion into a 2-unit, and that's council chambers at 5. And then we have committee of the whole in here at 6. Pending anything else, I'll ask for a motion to adjourn.
You got it.
Good night, everyone. Thank you.
Good work.